first session for today. It's a very interesting and very invigorating session, which is titled Urban Planning Myths and Imperatives. For this session, we are honored and privileged to have urban expert and author, Mr. Sameer Sharma, as the keynote speaker, who would be in conversation with Mr. Hitesh Vaidya and Professor Sanjay Gupta. Mr. Sameer Sharma is an urban expert and the first missions director for India's Smart City Mission Amrit and Capacity Building for Urban Development. He has been a recipient of several prestigious awards, including the President's Award for the Best State in Promotion of Community Organization in Slums in 2014. He is currently the head of the Indian Institute of Corporate Affairs. Mr. Hitesh Vaidya has more than 20 years of experience in the field of urban development policy and project formulation and assimilation for various UN and World Bank projects, and he's currently leading the National Institute of Urban Affairs, New Delhi. Professor Sanjay Gupta is an expert and professor in the field of transport planning, and he's currently the head of Urban Planning Department at the School of Urban Planning and Architecture, New Delhi. He has more than 3 decades of experience in the field of transport planning and urban development. I request our audience to please write down their questions, which they have from the esteemed author and the discussants, either in the Q&A box or the chat box. And I request Hitesh ji to please carry forward the session. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. And good evening from India. Happy New Year to everyone also. And thank you, Raghav Chandra sir, Sameer sir, and Sanjay ji, as a panelist here. This is a great proud moment for me personally to be in conversation with Dr. Sharma about his book. If I may say so, the way Lord Krishna always guided Arjuna's agitated mind to find the true essence of life, in my opinion, this book, two somewhat essays, similar role for the budding urban student, as it answers multiple queries on the future of urban planning in the country. I think this is a great book which intends to connect prevailing urban practices with planning principles. And it rightfully recognizes how Indian experiences and its Indian cities experiences are different from that of the West, and how these theories can really be applied, but have to have more contextual Indian, Indian platform to do a look at that. And I think COVID-19 has definitely provided us a great opportunity to bridge this mismatch between emerging new planning agendas and kind of education required to rethink, reimagine, and accelerate education and training for our future urban professionals. And this book tries to harness both intellectual and material planning perspectives for shaping cities through the formulation and implementation of policies, programs, and projects. And we have Dr. Sharma, who is a great author, rather than I talking about it, what we have thought out, we will have a conversation and dialogue with Dr. Sharma and ask him about his book and get the perspective which he brings in and he wants to the future urban planners to really think about the new transformation journey for the country. So, sir, thank you very much for being with us. And I'll start with things that with the same topic which you have talked about, planning. And can you please briefly explain about planning myths and implementation covered in this book? And in that context, even summarize the main contours of the book. Sir, over to you.
Thank you. Thank you, Raghavji, for calling me, and Hitesh and Dr. Gupta. The myth is that there are simple answers to India's urban problems, and just by introducing a few Western ideas, one can solve them. The imperative is to step beyond the objectivity of this Indian urban experience and looking at it from a Western point of view. At the same time, we have to use the frameworks and experience of the West as a lens to better understand the Indian urban landscape. Let me quote from Deepesh Chakravarti. For generations now, philosophers and thinkers have produced theories embracing the entire humanity. As you all know, these statements have been produced in relative and sometimes absolute ignorance of the majority of mankind, that is, those living in non-Western cultures. This in itself is not paradoxical, for the most self-conscious of European philosophers have always sought to theoretically justify this stance. The everyday paradox of the third world social science is that we find these theories, in spite of the inherent ignorance of us, eminently useful in understanding our societies. What allowed the modern European sages to develop such clairvoyance with regard to societies of which they were empirically ignorant? Why cannot we once again return the gaze? So this book is an attempt to return the gaze. How do I do this? This book describes the way a theory, in its widest sense of including frameworks, ideas, practices, paradigms, models, etc., how this theory worked its way through in the West, in a situation different from the Indian. These general statements of what causes what to happen and why are then paired with the circumstances prevailing in India. The pairing of the challenge in the Indian context and the Western theory is the distinct feature of this book. This enables visualization. The visualization includes the ability to predict what problems and opportunities are likely to occur in future for human settlements in India, as well as use theories to decide on what practitioners would need to do. Simply, practitioners put on a lens provided by Western theories to understand the application of theory in the Indian context. How does the book do this? This book rarely provides direct answers. What it does is to allow readers to run questions through a theory in their minds so that they know what the theory says is likely to be the result of one course of action compared to another. As a result, visualization is enabled and learners get to know what to think and how to think in the Indian context. Now, I have divided the evolution of Indian cities into four stages. The first is before the British rule, that is up to 1857. Then the colonial imprint from 1857 to 1947. Then the contrived development by India 1947 to 1991. And the last is globalization and urbanization, which is from 1991 till the present time. This book has seven chapters. The first two chapters are up to 1991. And the first chapter deals with what we call interurban structures, that is the hierarchy. How are the cities placed in a hierarchy, the largest cities, Bombay, Delhi, etc., then the next largest like this. The second deals with the intraurban hierarchy, that is what happens within a city. What is the structures and the shapes within the city? The third chapter deals with the structure and dynamics or the spatial structures and how they evolved in Indian settlements after 1991. The fourth chapter deals with regional development, the fifth with urban planning, and the sixth with urban governance, and the last with social landscapes. This is about the book. Yes, Hitesh, please.
Thank you, sir. I will ask Professor Sanjay Gupta to talk about it, because both of us will be alternative talking about it. So I'll ask Gupta to
proceed. Thank you, Professor Vaidya, and a very good evening to all of you. It's my pleasure and honor to be among such distinguished invitees and guests here. At the outset, sir, my huge compliment for writing such a fabulous book, which probably I'm sure will be very, very useful for the students of planning. In fact, when I was going through it, let me acknowledge that I couldn't go through it very thoroughly because it's such an intense book. But at a glance, which I went through it, I think it has got everything a student of urban planning should aspire to learn. And I think that is a compliment which I would like to share with you. I think you've brought out very interesting comment here that at the time of India's independence, if you could elaborate, what were the structures and dynamics of India as compared to the West? And I would request that if you could probably touch upon issues of what we interestingly called, what is called a dynamic vertical trade versus static horizontal trade. Sir.
Thank you. Now, all of us are aware, colonialism shaped the economies as well as the roles and distribution of cities in the developing nations. Now, India had a well-developed urban system, and these pre-colonial cities were occupied and turned into centers of imperial control. Cities were centers to extract raw materials from the hinterland and supply goods manufactured in the West. At the time India was colonized in the early 18th century, the Industrial Revolution had already occurred in Britain. India became a supplier of raw materials and a market for finished goods produced in Britain. At the same time, hefty tariffs were imposed on traditional Indian manufacturing. The result was the Indian trade industry declined and a sort of ruralization set in. What did the British do? The British, in order to serve the economic needs of colonialism, focused on developing port cities of Mumbai, Chennai, Kolkata, and later Delhi, and connecting them to the hinterland by railways. Later, these cities on their own did emerge as market centers to manufacture low-value industrial goods. Over time, they did acquire metropolitan dominance due to population increase, railroad connectivity, and economic growth. Now, at the time of India's independence, this inordinate dependence of India on four primate cities was a major imperative to be addressed. Now, as Dr. Gupta was saying about the vertical and horizontal trade, the British did reorient the economic system of India, and they focused on vertical and not horizontal trade. The output of a few specialized commodities lines of primary production was expanded for export. In the colonial enterprise system, investments were made in mines, plantations, and tea gardens, and therefore their movement to the port cities. In turn, the facilities for payments were made for reverse flow from the port cities to the local areas. This is called vertical trade. In contrast, horizontal trade consists of buying provisions in the rural markets for urban middle class and selling industrial or other city goods to them. In India, the British did not focus on the development of horizontal trade, and any development of horizontal trade was more of a byproduct of vertical trade. Thus, an economic system emerged that consisted of a dynamic vertical trade and a static horizontal trade. Importantly, the vertical trade was all connected to the metropole called London. So this is an imperative to be addressed. Now, this skewed economic system had effects in the urban system of India. The spatial system developed like a dendrite. Now think of a tree with a main branch and side branches. That's a dendrite. Now, so cities in India, there was a railway line, Bombay to Delhi, Bombay leading to interiors, and this developed like a tree pattern called a dendrite. In contrast, in the West, as I will tell you later, this developed into hexagonal pattern. Hexagonal pattern is one city like, say, Delhi, with six smaller cities surrounding it. Those six, again, surrounded by six smaller cities. So you have these layers of hexagonal patterns with smaller settlements surrounding a larger city. Now, this dendrite system consisted of three components. One was the major port cities with strong linkages to Britain, the three port cities. The second was the strategic cities connected to port cities and in turn connected to local cities in the interior hinterlands. They built linear forms of transport links to connect port cities to strategic cities to what we call bulk exports, consolidate purchase of primary products, and break wholesale lots of consumer goods for distribution through small markets. The third type of city or settlement was the dispersed local marketplace. These were dependent again on strategic cities for transport, processing, storage, etc. In local marketplaces, artisan products and agriculture commodities were exchanged locally. And the British did engage in ancillary activities such as establishing transport and communication facilities, maintaining law and order, and later creating regulated markets for agriculture products. So in the dendrite pattern, we had the port cities, the strategic cities, and the dispersed local market. Now, the issue of agriculture market committees, which you are seeing today, actually was started during the British times. And they set up these AMCs at that time to sort of collect this raw material for export and also consolidating all this in the AMCs. Now, the first AMC they set up was in Hyderabad in 1897. And later on, then they extended this. There's one in Bombay, in central provinces, Madras, Punjab, etc. You look at the spatial pattern which developed as a result of this dendritic spatial pattern of settlements in India. Johnson in 1965 found that in India, on an average, there were 468 villages for every town. Now, if suppose we had the interurban hierarchy of the United States. And our hierarchy was not as skewed due to colonialism as it was. India would have had 47,000 towns. Inscription just had 2,000. So imagine the impact of colonialism in sort of compelling India to a spatial structure which had such negative connotations. So the hierarchy of cities that developed was different, and integration between cities and villages did not happen due to the imposition of the colonial economic system. And again, this is an imperative to be addressed. In the West, what happened? Imagine a small town and you set up a manufacturing plant. The manufacturing plant requires workers. These workers get salary. With this money, they stay in a residence, they hire a place, or they build a house. Then they spend this money. All this is the multiplier effect. Then in turn, when they require barbers, so barber shops will come up. Their family also spends money. So this is the way a industry, when it was located in the western towns during the Industrial Revolution, helped the town to develop. You know, the economic activity through what we call multiplier effects led to the development of these towns in the West. Now, these cities which were developed in the West had a complementary relationship with the surrounding hinterland. You can also call the other cities around it as tributaries, which provide goods and services and got cash in return. Now, each of these cities had a trade area, which was the area where it had its social, political, and economic influence. And this trade area was hexagonal shaped, which is the most efficient form for cities to be located next to one another. This did not happen in India. In fact, in India, it could be circular or it could be actually no shape. So you had this sort of punctuated cities in India throughout. There are none of these what we call the central places with hexagonal trade areas. And this sort of a very bad economically driven spatial structure of India, you know, was one of the major reasons for lack of development of India even after independence. Yes, please.
Thank you, sir. And you, I think, very nicely explained how cities of economic aspects and physical aspects of cities really shaped, how Indian cities got shaped during the after the independence and all. But what do you see, sir, after the post-independence? How do you really look at the, how did the Indian urban system post-independence really evolved? And was contrived development able to measure up to India's imperatives?
After independence, right up to say 1991, there was contrived development by government. I call it contrived development because it was largely led by the five-year plans. 1991 is a key year because, of course, all of us know India opened up. Another was that the National Commission on Urbanization was set up in 1985, chaired by Charles Koria and I guess the vice chairman and one of the members was Mr. M.N. Butch from the Madhya Pradesh Cadre, another one of the legends in urban sector in India. Now, so this contrived development period, the entire urban development was subsumed within the five-year plans. You'll be surprised to note that the word urban did not occur in our constitution. And the only place they talked of, not even urban, but local bodies, was in the directive principles. And so same thing happened in the five-year plans, where the urban development was thought as an offshoot of industrial development and confused with housing. And they thought that once industrialization happened, urban development would happen automatically. So after partition, around 15 million people were compelled to relocate as refugees. So naturally, the first two five-year plans were completely oriented towards housing and rehabilitation of the refugees. And they set up rehabilitation colonies in Delhi, Mumbai, Ahmedabad, UP, Kolkata. Center provided subsidy. And this scope of housing was expanded during the late 50s or the second five-year plan. And what they also started was the town and country planning organization to provide guidance and assistance for urban planning. They did recognize that urban planning was required. What did the TCPO did was they took the British town and country planning law and made a model town and country planning law and then gave it to all the states to prepare their own town and country planning laws. The highlight of the town and country plan was the preparation of a master plan. Now, so this focus on urban housing was there. In the third plan, they realized that government funds were just not sufficient to provide housing. And there were resource constraints, there were high costs for housing, and they were only touching a small fringe of the problem. So they thought that we had to sort of go, besides government, there had to be additional cooperative and private effort. And in the 70s, they set up the HUDCO. And they set up a lot of these urban development authorities and housing boards. And they also provided loan, HUDCO provided loan to Chandigarh, Bhubaneswar, Gandhinagar and Bhopal as new cities. Then in the 70s, they start a lot of slums which had developed in India, particularly the large cities. So they started programs for environment improvement of urban slums. Then in the late 70s, they found they didn't have land to build housing. Inequitous distribution of land. So the urban land ceiling regulation law was brought in. They also realized that large cities were continuing to grow. These four big cities were continuing to grow and the smaller cities were not growing. So they brought in a program for integrated development of small and medium towns. And this integrated development of small and medium towns took off in the 80s. And then they also brought in the private sector into housing construction in the late 80s. And in 85, they appointed a National Commission Organization. It had 11 members, and Charles Correa and M.N. Butch were the most prominent members. And they observed that the urban policies were being prepared in the narrow context of industrialization under the assumption that urbanization is coterminous with industrialization. This is what the NCU found. They were focusing on housing and relegating urbanization to a subsidiary status. The commission suggested a complete a new paradigm in which policymaking would move away from linking urban development housing, and urbanization itself would become a driver of economic development. So cities, instead of remaining isolated centers of economic activity with weak linkages to the hinterland, should become vibrant centers and make full use of natural human resources in the region, and over time expand their economic role beyond the region. They also said that spatial planning should be integrated with economic and social planning and become a major instrument of agriculture and rural development, including anti-poverty program. Spatial planning should be used to prevent the lopsided development of settlements. And they also supported the idea of urban-rural continuum and a balanced system of settlements. Please recall our former president, Abdul Kalam had also spoken about this urban-rural continuum and the rural-urban program. You know, this gap between rural and urban. And concretely, the National Commission on Urbanization suggested that we identify cities to be developed so as to fill this gap in the hierarchy. You know, this gap which I had spoken, in which the number of towns was so less as compared to villages. And they identified 329 cities, which they called generators of economic momentum. And they also identified 49 what spatial priority urban regions. So fill the gap, identify on medium and focus on medium and small cities, as well as spatial priority regions, were the recommendations of the National Commission on Urbanization. That is up to 1991.
Great, sir. So you did talk about the whole system which evolved post 1990 and how really started looking at different formation of intra urban elements and other things. So just wanted to know that why this all thing happened. If tell what, how did this be started convergence towards looking at evolving urban system within this country?
Hitesh, you know, in the West, all of us, when we think of cities, we think of these central business district, or what we call the CBDs. Now, CBDs was the place which developed during the Industrial Revolution. Railway lines were built in and out of CBDs, and industries were located. And, you know, that was the place where this manufacturing happened, and lots of raw materials came in, and the distribution of finished goods went on from there. So we had the warehousing, the distribution networks, everything. This was what the West called the monocentric city. Okay. After World War II, this CBD lost its importance, and we got to see in the West what you call the polycentric cities. In a polycentric city, there are several downtowns located around the earlier major city. And one major contribution to this suburban expansion was the development of transport networks and the use of personal automobiles. And these suburban formations are called by different names like mini city, metro towns, and the most famous as edge cities, which the name given by Joel Garou in the 90s to these suburban formations. Now, so in the West, you had the monocentric city, then you had the polycentric cities developing. What happened in India at the same time? 1991, India opened up. Opened up, the spatial impact of this was that industries could be located in cities if they were non-polluting. If they were polluting, there was no restriction on cities up to 1 million. But above 1 million, they could be located within beyond 25 kilometers from city limits. So the 1991 also opened up the space around cities, small cities, and encouraged the non-polluting industries, electronics, computers, software, printing. Now, since the 1990s, this IT-enabled back office services outsourced from the West have become the key driver of Indian economy. And this was the result of confluence of several factors. One was there was an exponential advance in information communication technologies. The second was the Y2K. You know, in the year 2000, they were thinking it all collapsed. So they put a lot of money and research into ensuring that the information communication technologies sort of went on without any disruption when the year 2000 came. In India at that time, you know, there was a deregulation of higher education. Recall up to late 80s, there's hardly any private colleges. And this deregulation particularly happened in Karnataka and Andhra Pradesh. Now this generated a lot of engineers within a short time. Now, this coupled with the growing skill shortage in the West, a lot of US and European corporations were attracted to outsource services to India. At the same time, the WTO was signed in the 90s. And this and the restriction capital flows in the world reduced. Multinational corporations could deploy capital anywhere in the world without fear of repatriation of profits. Finally, geography worked for India. There's a 12 and a half hour difference between India and the Pacific Standard Time. This allowed Indians to perform maintenance and re-engineering tasks for US customers by accessing the computers after regular users in the US went home. So while US slept, India worked. At the same time, the central and state governments also became entrepreneurial. You know, state governments themselves became entrepreneurs, particularly the state governments of Karnataka, Andhra Pradesh, and even Haryana. And the Indian government also provided 20 years of tax holiday under the Software Technology Park Scheme of India, extended by another 15 years. And state governments also gave a lot of incentives. So cities which had a lot of land around them, had educated workforce, developed. And this competition between state governments also happened in the US and is called competitive boosterism. At the same time, in the US also there's a growth machine. And the growth machine in the US sort of mirrored the growth machine in India. And I'll soon tell you about Gurugram and Bangalore later also, in which, you know, there were these land, people with land, there were these, the political executive, the bureaucratic executive, the bankers, all of them combined to bring about growth. You know, so it's like a growth machine. It worked like a machine. And So there was a convergence in terms of the way cities were developing in the West and in India. You had a polycentric system. The polycentric was slightly different. Like Delhi, if you look at it, the polycentric system could be Gurgaon and Noida. For Hyderabad, it would be the cyber city, Gachibowli area. Same Bangalore, Pune. So you know, you had this polycentricism coming out, although in a different way, because naturally the starting spatial structure was different. At the same time, there were several other convergences which happened with the West. One was we had these dual cities now. So we had the emergence of IT business parks, gated residential township and shopping malls in the peri-urban areas of these cities. Enclaves similar to the West have also emerged in the Indian cities, and these are situated alongside old rural habitats in peri-urban areas and the multiple existing cores of the city also. So there's a fragmented landscape like the West. And at the same time, high levels of poverty still remain, leading to a dual city. The other thing which is called is that this capital, unlike earlier where it would come, pick up a land which was according to the master plan and then develop that. This changed. And this is called Kino capitalism. Kino is a game where you pick up some numbers and then they call the numbers. If you win it, you get the money. So something like a housing only. So this global capital was also came in search of the cheapest available land, honed in on this peri-urban space surrounding the cities. And these particular pieces of land around the cities owe their development to the utility in the global economy rather than local requirements. Such development is not truly random, but has an underlying order that is shaped by the Indian version of a growth machine. So the way growth machine crafted the space in Gurgaon is very different from the way it crafted it in Noida. So the growth machine again exists primarily at the state level, unlike US where it exists at the city level with peers, is built around entrepreneurial government supported by financial institutions, banks, export industry, property dealers, builders, infrastructure firms, contractors, education institutions, hospitals, and the bureaucracy. The overriding goal is growth primarily through land consumption and attracting investment in the built environment. So the city land becomes like a game board for the growth machine to reshuffle land uses, that is mix and redistribute. So you had a lot of changes of land use from the master plan. While the urban planning still continued to be focused on the enforcement of building regulation and preparation of master plans. However, it did become co-opted and became a part of the coalition, which assisted this growth machine to shuffle land uses and zoning regulations to achieve the economic growth agendas. It is not the other parts were insulated. This Kino capital also came into the city, demolished a lot of buildings, or just picked up open space and built construction of malls, retail outlets, and apartment complexes. The other convergence which happened was urban renewal. You know, in France, they have prefects who are similar to our district magistrates. And there was one prefect called Baron von Haussmann in the 1840s. He was given a mandate to regularize Paris. So what he did, he demolished nearly 30-40% of Paris, built these straight roads. And what you see of Paris is a large part due to Haussmann. And this process was labeled as Haussmannization. The Americans did it after World War II and they called it urban renewal. And they completely renewed their CBDs with this. So this was another convergence. The last point of convergence was, you know, there was this social polarization in cities leads to what we call fortress mentality. And the rich live behind walls to keep out other groups, particularly the poor. While the fortress mentality always existed, globalization after 1991 has only increased it. And this spatial polarization is also resulting in what we call totalization, referring to the increasing proclivity to provide a complete range of services within spatially separated parts of cities. So you have cities which provide all the services, they're totally contained in the city in their own, and they contain all the services within. So this does reduce opportunities for people to meet in common places and less interaction, leading to reduced intergroup trust.
Great, sir. And I before I hand over to my fellow panelists, I tend to just pick up one question which was really, you know, coming in the, on the chat box, which I think talked about the areas where you touched upon. And it said that railways was big driving force for the development of cities, but the railway lines themselves started dividing the suburban towns. So, you know, your thoughts on that, while you are talking about the shaping and convergence and with the planning and the railway authorities, and if you can just highlight quickly before the, my fellow panelists take up the next.
It is just tell me the question. You're talking of the Indian Railways or the metros?
No, Indian Railways, sir. It was talking about Indian Railways was a big driving force for development of cities, but the railway lines themselves started dividing suburban towns. And I think it has been asked by Meera Das, who is also there. So if you want a little more explanation, she can give. But I just thought you talked about whole division of the cities and the way things are happening. So I thought it's good to pick up this question at this stage itself rather than waiting until later.
Meera, could you tell me this, what division are you... I mean, I just want to, from my understanding, this division of suburban towns or the peri-urban areas. Could you tell me a little more examples so that I could tell you then?
There were two studies which were done. I mean, even when I was involved in one of them. So the inner cities, see, the railway lines kind of changed the development pattern in Bhopal distinctly. And then as the new growth started happening on the outer periphery of the old towns, the old towns became kind of like slums and they got neglected and new services was not given. And the railway line kind of, since there were not bridges to kind of connect the two sides, it started becoming, one side becoming, started becoming more greater focus. And I mean, it actually became the fort walls where you had the richer suburban people staying on one side and the poorer ones on the other side of the railway line. And we studied too, even Gurgaon has that division where you find that the on one side of the railway line are the very posh and, you know, very high rise. And so a lot of money goes into that part of the city, whereas the other part of the city, which was older, which is poorer and all that, suffers from various infrastructure services, everything. So, and we've not been able to kind of work along with the railways, you know, altering it and changing it as the cities grew. That was broadly what I had.
I completely agree with you. You know, railways in India, railway lines in India are associated with a lot of, settlements. The poor people, one of the places they used to come to a city and stay was the canal banks or the railway banks. We call it the railway banks because there was land available, right? And at least the municipalities would not throw them out saying, this is not our land, you know, go, this is somebody else's land. So that is a place where it developed. So definitely, you know, wherever there was private land beyond that, it became very rich. So what you say is absolutely right. I mean, conceptually, it should happen.
The second,
I'll ask Sanjay to pick up next question.
I think Ms. Meera was asking, I mean, you can continue with a small, is she asking or should I think she was.
No, we have to mind the time also because okay. We should not be ready.
So I think I would now take you towards the master planning, practices in our country. I'm sure we all are aware that there are various levels of planning, right? From regional to the outline development plan to the master plan to the local zonal plan and finally to the local area plan. And often master plans have been criticized for that they have outlived the utilities. Now, would you kind of enlarge this point? And I would just want to add up further. What are your views? Because there is a question attached to it. What are your views looking into how the smart cities, which is the new mission program of the ministry, has it brought any changes in the urban India?
Okay. So the master plan, again, as I had said earlier, was the result of a town and country law, which the TCPO asked the state governments to do. And it was based on the British law of 1947. So the master plan basically is an abstract plan, which decides which land use and where will the roads be located in the cities. So this master plan was reviewed by the National Commission on Urbanization in 1985. And what did they find? They found that master planning had led to a static built environment, which is largely disconnected from the rapidly changing socioeconomic conditions in urban areas of India. Now, in order to address the fluid, constantly transforming conditions in urban areas, state governments resort to frequent land use changes and building regularization schemes to legalize building uses in contravention of existing master plans. Second, the master plans are unconnected to investment planning at the city, state, and national levels. As a result, master plans have largely remained unimplemented. Third, master plans fail to be truly comprehensive due to the missing link between the spatial and functional aspects. On a regional and national scale, this lack of integration of spatial planning and economic planning has increased the skewed hierarchy of settlements, which was originally created by colonialism. And most importantly, benefits of a lot of economic planning and development schemes has not been realized because the spatial system was so skewed. Now, the challenge is we have so many cities with master plans, I guess somewhere in the range of 400 to 500. What to do? Now, the National Commission on Urbanization also said that now you should transit from master plans to execution plans. Have a master plans. See how well the abstract plan can be executed in the next 2 years, seeing the way land uses changes are happening and the way city is developing. Then once in 2 years, you decide these are the changes we'll do, consult the public and revise the master plan, make it into two-year execution plans. At the same time, you know, we use what we call Cartesian codes. So strict land use, building with setbacks, heights, plot coverage. But there's another set of codes which is called form-based codes. And this leads to one of the original ideas which I always sort of propagate. We took up the modern pathway after 47 based on what the West had done. But the West in the 80s found it was not working in the way, and they sort of transited into the postmodern approach. In this postmodern approach, we have what we call form-based codes. I'll not speak on that, it's a big subject itself. Form-based codes, by and large, you can say, are also what we call new traditional codes, and to a large extent reflect what was happening in India prior to the time British came. And then this execution plan, back to master plan again, should have clear budgets and requires coordination among land use, transportation, etc. So this is one way to get over the master plan. About the smart cities. You see, I joined the smart cities mission after 6 months, and we had had some 200, 250 presentations, and the mandate was to develop a mission. And, you know, up to now, I have just sort of told you what happened in India. There was a focus on infrastructure, there's focus on small and regional towns, there's focus on poverty alleviation, slum development. Now, I sort of take you to Patrick Geddes. Patrick Geddes came in 1915 to 19. Unlike what the British were doing to India at that time, they were building up cantonments, they were building up railway lines, they were building military lines. Patrick Geddes, 1915 to 1919, came and he prepared plans for 18 cities, including cities like Balrampur, Lucknow, Indore, Madurai, Tangier. Now, Geddes said first, he said diagnosis before treatment, and then treatment was conservative surgery. So you would go into a locality like, say, Chandni Chowk, do detailed surveys, and then recommend a conservative surgery. In fact, today, the development of Chandni Chowk, if you look at it, is what we call in urban planning a postmodern intervention, and to a large extent is what Patrick Geddes had thought would work for India. So when we went for smart cities, we had three broad areas. One was to provide infrastructure for the whole city, which was water supply, sewerage, underground sewerage. The second part was to integrate the interactions between the citizens and the built environment using digital technology. So how would you do it? You're driving a car, there'll be a camera which takes a photograph of you crossing the red light, and it automatically you get a ticketing. So this sort of capturing the interactions of citizens with the built environment digitally. The third and the most difficult was, you pick up these earlier settlements in India like Chandni Chowk, Karol Bagh, etc., make them pedestrian, improve them, improve the environment, which means you redesign them. And at the time of the smart city mission also, we knew this was the most important and would take the maximum time. And this is what has happened. Infrastructure Amrut has taken off. The integrated 2C centers, command control centers, more than 50 cities are established. Area-based development, which you used to call, has been the most difficult. And the perfect example is Chandni Chowk or Bangalore or in Chennai. They have just done, and they were telling me the chief minister said they wanted to expand it to other cities. And I was reading just 2 days ago that Saudi Arabia is building a linear city. And this city will not have any roads. It'll have no roads, no cars. $500 billion, this city. So this development of localities, upgradation of localities based on postmodernism of for India, what Geddes had proposed, and the contemporary connotation of Geddes or what we call in urban planning, new urbanism. I mean, I don't want to go into a lot of this jargon, but generally, it was supposed to take into consideration the prevailing historical styles on streets, recognize the varying preferences of house owners. Here, there are house owners who follow vastus to give them that freedom within the plot coverage. Somebody wants an open balcony, another wants a closed and projecting one, while somebody prefers a decorated window. So this, you know, looking after the individual preferences of house owners. Therefore, it was a switch from the regular and formula driven style to an individual and free driven style. And this is what was the most difficult part of smart cities, and which is the slowest in terms of implementations. So what were they trying? Walkability, smaller lot size, houses close to another, narrower streets, people can walk. Then there's a lot of functional integration like we found in COVID, you know. The need for open cities, the need for parks, the need to be able to walk on streets, talk to one another, go to the Kirana store, gossip, all that is lost. And this was one of the aims of the smart cities.
Okay. Should I take a question, Professor Vaidya, or aap karenge? Because I don't know how much time we have. There is a question in the chat box.
Yeah, I think we have a little running short of time and minding time. I will just talk about it, sir. You talked about Patrick Geddes. You talked about master planning, and also I think I'll just quickly think. One of the biggest concern is this within our governing system is fragmentation of roles and responsibilities at the institutional level, at the local level, and you know there was where does the buck really stops? So looking at the Western governance structures. How do we really look at similarity with India's emerged structures for a governance and institutional level at the local level? So that's the one question. And I'll parallelly ask a question which is on the chat box related to this, which I you know, it's a long question, but I said that it says, what surprises me is that in the Western Europe with the full open democracies, the skyline is both systematical and aesthetic. What special laws exist in Europe which gave a flip to the amazing architecture? So it's like, you know, how did we manage the beauty which is happening in the housing and built environment in Europe, whereas why can't we manage in our cities that? So I think it also requires who really governs our city. So if you can really highlight that.
Hitesh, you know, surprisingly, we think that in US mayors are very powerful. They are in some cities, but they have, we can say, four systems. One is a weak mayor system. The weak mayor system, mayor hardly has any powers. And a lot of the powers have been given to appointed boards and commissions, each entrusted with the responsibility to provide a specific municipal service. And the weak mayor system was created to shield municipal operations from the unwise actions of what the Americans call ill-trained, power-hungry, or partisan mayors. The second is a strong mayor system, which you see in New York, Los Angeles, the larger cities. And this mayor works something like the US president with a lot of checks and balances through council confirmation on his appointees, etc. Then we have there's a commissioner system, which we will recognize as we have the administrators or special officers in cities. So this was started actually in Galveston in Texas in 1900 when there was a hurricane. And they called in five experts to oversee all the operation. This became the commission system. And in theory, the fusion of legislative and executive powers in one person was expected to lead to quick action. This was replicated several places, but in the recent past, cities have gone away from this. And presently, the only large city having this is Portland. Now, then we have the council manager system, and this council manager system was to have a professional city manager, and so started in 1908 in Virginia. And this proved successful, and then this was implemented in Dayton, Ohio in 1913. And today, more than half the cities have this council manager system. And this is particularly popular in mid-sized cities. And in this system, the council appoints a professionally trained manager who is given charge of day-to-day affairs. And there are several advantages, you know, of the council manager system. But there is a complaint that they're not that politically savvy. And, you know, mayor is held responsible for everything, but the powers lie with the council. And now in India, like in the US, urban is a state subject. Please remember, in US also it's a state subject. And these have been given to the cities. However, unlike US, except for Article 40, there is no mention of urban. It is only in 73rd and 74th amendments in 1993 that urban was recognized as a place where there had to be a governance structure. And we had three types: municipal corporation, municipal council, and the Nagar Panchayat. This classification shows that the parliament recognized that these three types require different types of corporate, different types of governance structures. But again, there has been no common feature of governance within all these. And generally in India, we have four types of governance systems which have evolved. One is what we call the strong commissioner system or the council manager system in US, which occurs in the West and the South. So you have Karnataka, Andhra Pradesh, Gujarat, Maharashtra, Tamil Nadu. Then you have the weak commissioner system, which is in the North and also to a certain extent the East, where the power is with the urban development authorities and the commissioners are weak. In fact, you wouldn't possibly know the commissioners of a lot of North Indian states. You know the vice chairman of the UDAs or the district magistrates, which is absolutely opposite of South. When you go to Bombay, you would never know who is the MADA vice chairman or the district magistrate of Mumbai. Then we have the strong mayor system where you have council mayor in Kolkata. And you have then the fourth is the administrator or special officer system, mirroring the commission system of the West, which you have in these industrial area authorities like Hyderabad and Jamshedpur. Another unique feature of India are the parastatals. You know, parastatals have been created and the housing boards in the 70s. And there was a need at that time. There was no capacity in the cities. Cities governance was largely looked after still by the district magistrates, etc. So they created a lot of these parastatals being controlled from the state headquarters. Now, coming to the skyline of the West and this, what happened in the West, first was a blank slate, particularly in the suburbs. It was land. So they could build the way they wanted. Second was, particularly in the US, the central business districts were torn down by what we call urban renewal or hospitalization. And then they rebuilt it according to a very strong plan. The third is in those countries, it is not easy to deviate from the plan except the flexibility which is allowed in the plan. So it's very difficult for them to build a multi-storied building of where there are two stories allowed to build six stories, where you have single family accommodation to build apartments. That is just not done. That is never allowed. So as Hitesh was saying, this is connected to governance. And I would like to go back and also tell that In India, the 1919 Government of India Act did focus a lot on cities. So you had mayors like Subhash Chandra Bose in Calcutta, Jawaharlal Nehru in Allahabad, Patel in Ahmedabad, Rajgopalachari in Chennai, Rajendra Prasad in Patna. All of them imagined prime minister material, and they were mayors. So 1919 was focused on cities in India. 1935 shifted the entire balance to the states. So in this period of contrived development since independence to 1991, lack of focus on the governance structure. So you had all these slums coming up, all these constructions happening, but there's hardly any control. The deviations were more of a norm than an exception. And this has led to such different outcomes for the West and us.
Sir, you also in your earlier book, and I tend to ask this question because in your earlier book, you had quoted under this book, which is called Smart City and Revolt, you have quoted Professor Raja Challaiya, who said everyone wants decentralization, but only up to his level. So what type of decentralization model actually we are looking for in India? And there was a parallel question on the chat box, which I think related to it. And because of time, I tend to take that also. What do you think the 10 top priorities when it comes to the urban planning in the next decade? So if you can, you know, talk about decentralization model as well as the planning urban planning priorities for the country, we can really bring that session to a closure after that.
You know, Professor Raja Challaiya made this very interesting observation. He says, everyone in India wants decentralization, but only up to their level. And they don't want it to go down. So state governments want up to state, not up to cities. The mayors want up to themselves and not up to wards. And at the ward level, they don't want to give this to the citizens. So, you know, there are four forms of decentralization. One is this devolution, which is, you know, the central, concurrent and state list. So at that time, if we had also made a city list, we did say 18 functions to go to city, but did not make a city list. So first type is devolution. Second is delegation, where, you know, some defined functions are given to local bodies outside the normal bureaucratic structure, which means these 18 functions which are given to the municipal bodies. The third is deconcentration, where the powers of government are given to urban development authorities or the heads of the parastatals like the water board, etc. And the last is divestment, where you entrust these bodies outside the regular machinery and you give it to self-help groups or you give it to associations of people like the resident welfare stations in Delhi. So these are four types. Now the challenge which comes is how and what to delegate and to what extent. The Administrative Reforms Commission, the second Administrative Reforms Commission, focused on the principle called the principle of subsidiarity. Now, unlike delegation, which works from the top, everything is the top and then you sort of slowly give it down. Subsidiarity says no, everything is the bottom. And whatever the most bottom level cannot do, you delegate upwards. So it is a sort of reverse delegation. And functions which can be done at the lowest level should be done at the smallest unit of governance. And the Administrative Reforms Commission said that we should use the subsidiarity principles to allocate functions, funds and functionaries to different levels, including the lowest level of ward or even areas below that, like the resident welfare associations. And then whatever they cannot do, stuff like, you know, transportation, which covers several jurisdictions, water supply also not the decentralized, the centralized water supply, centralized sewage management system, etc. to them. So decentralization to work in such diverse societies like India should be based on the principle of subsidiarity.
I think I might have time. Sanjay ji, if you have a quick question, if you want to.
I think I was just trying to kind of a very quick response from Dr. Sherpa would be, what do you think would be the possible emerging trends in view of probably the current pandemic environment? Would you find some changes in the way the urban planning is being done, particularly looking into social distancing, looking into need for open spaces, looking into work from home opportunities? Do you foresee anything happening?
You know, I last week I wrote an article on making local vocal Honorable Prime Minister's slogan on how we can apply to urban planning. So if you take vocal for local, you have to make it the local vocal, which means pick up these areas, the traditional settlements in India, and make them walkable, right? Build up their parks, improve their environment, decentralize sewerage, clean the sewerage, decentralize the solid waste management. So you have to make the local vocal. So that is the first. The second is, as we've been talking, you know, this transportation, look at Saudi Arabia, full of oil. They're building cities without cars. This dependence on vehicles and cars has to come down. There's no way.
We are running. It was a wonderful and beautiful and scintillating session, but we are just running out of time and the next session is lined up. So I would request you to
close
the session.
No, thank you, sir. Thank you, everyone. Thank you, panelists. But I think I still stand by my first sentence, sir, which was an opening sentence, which is during this whole conversation. It's like Krishna answering the agitated mind of Arjuna. And I definitely see that this book will definitely open up the agitated minds of a lot of students and the practitioners on the urban planning. So thank you, everyone. And thank you for giving this opportunity to talk to Dr. Sharma, and thanks Sanjay Gupta and all other panelists there, and thanks again to Dr. Raghav Chandra. Back to Mrinalini for your closing remarks.
Thank you, Sameer. Thank you, Sanjay.
Thank you,
Dr. Vaidya.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Sameer, Professor Sanjay, and Hiteshji. It was an invigorating and enlightening session. We learned a lot of new perspectives on urban planning and various nuances of town development and smart city development. It threw an entirely different and a new light on the subject. And I'm sure a lot of people would learn different things, different aspects from the book written by Dr. Sharma, and thank you so much. We wanted the session to go on, but we have another session lined up, so we had to close it. So thank you so much. Thanks once again.
Thank you.
So now we move towards the second and the last session of this day and BLF 2021, which is titled Taming the Dragon. And for this session, we have two very distinguished speakers with us, Brigadier Sanjay Agarwal and Mr. Shiv Kunal Verma. They would be in conversation with Raghav Chandra ji. Brigadier Sanjay Agarwal he needs no introduction. He belongs to the Indian military service. He's fought wars and he served in Siachen as well. We all know Siachen is like difficult conditions. He has been a former security advisor to the Ministry of Home Affairs and earlier to the government of Seychelles. Mr. Shiv Kunal Verma is an Indian military historian and a noted documentary filmmaker.
Bhopal Literature Festival. It went off well.
He's best known for his book, 1962, The War That Wasn't, which was a detailed study about the Sino-India War, which was fought in the year 1962. I request Chandraji to please carry forward the session. And I also request our audience to please post their questions either in the Q&A or the chat box. Thank you so much.
Welcome to two very, very distinguished panelists, Shiv Kunal Verma, who is well known in military circles as perhaps the best chronicler of military and history events, and Brigadier Sanjay Agarwal, who is also a great field operative and military officer, and who has been participating in many, many rounds of discussions. Let me welcome you all first, and now I go on to say that this session on taming the dragon that we are going to have now is really looking at a subject, hence, that is not only a popular conversation piece this topical from various angles: national security, regional peace, and global dynamics. There's scarcely any international report or analysis that we come across on any subject, diplomacy, strategy, economy, trade, health, that ever ignores China. And despite being our close neighbor and also sharing similar perspectives and challenges such as demography, ecology, and geography, the India-China relationship has always been on the edge. India's perspective of China is also fueled by global commentaries about an aggressive China ready to engulf and ensnare the world. However, when China aggressively itself raises its shin against India from time to time at border flashpoints like Doklam, Galvan Valley, Ladakh, etc., when it blocks global terrorists from being blacklisted, when it supports Pakistan, knowing fully well the implications for us, naturally, potential and even imminent threat posed today by China, which is seen as clearly expansionist and a horrible bully. So it is very timely indeed that we are talking about this subject of the China imbroglio or problem, as we may call it, and how we can contain threats from China with these two very, very distinguished military experts, one who has been in the field, the other who is a solid military historian. And as we've mentioned, we will take questions from the audience and will give you adequate opportunity to raise your thoughts and your questions. Chief Kunal, let me begin by mentioning that you have been the author of this book called 1962, The War That Wasn't. You've authored The Long Road to Siachen, The Question Why. Your father, Major General Verma, was an infantry officer from the two Rajputs that were actively involved in the 1962 war. And you have your own ground reconnaissance. You speak with authority. You've written articles on China, which I've had the occasion to read. I'm also conscious of the fact that in one place, Mr. Subramaniam Swamy, in fact, tweeted that you should be an advisor to the defense minister. Brigadier Agarwal, I'm conscious of the fact that you are a fighting soldier. You've spent 2 years in Bhutan. You were deputed by our government to train their bodyguards, the king's bodyguards, and Bhutan's army and police. You've been a mountaineer and were awarded the president's medal for scaling Mount Gori Chen in Arunachal Pradesh, which was basically, now it can be disclosed, was an operational reconnaissance in unpatrolled super high altitude areas along the Chinese border. Your second award from the President of India was for capturing of a Pakistani post in Siachen Glacier in 1984. So let me come straight to discussion. Kunal, your book, 1962, The War That Wasn't, was published by a Left Book Company in January 2016. It's become a bestseller. You've been very candid in your illustrations about the casualties on the Indian side, with some survivors even describing the events on the Eastern Front, two Rajputs, and who knows that better than you, at Namka Chu and others as a complete massacre. The audience would certainly like to know in detail about your findings from the book, The 1962, The War That Wasn't, of what exactly are your conclusions, your findings, your research. Please take your time and tell us all about your research and findings about this book.
Thank you, Raghav, and it's a pleasure to be here with you and Brigadier Agarwal. I didn't know Sanjay had climbed Gori Chen. That's the highest peak in Arunachal, and the closest I've been to it by helicopter, but it's one of the most stunning physical mountains that you will actually see. The 62 book was something which I suppose I was born to write, if I may say so. I was 2 years old when the war happened. I was born in 1960. And my father was from 2nd Rajput, as you said, and though he later commanded 18, And for us, it was the whole family got wiped out. I mean, you know, we lost 282 men in Namkachu. And I saw for myself, even though I was 2 years old, I have recollection, I have very clear recollections of exactly the, you know, just how the whole horror had engulfed the whole country, because we were living it. We were living it day and out. And, you know, even as a 2 year, 3 year old kid, there are flashes of memories. And then, of course, there was so much talk around it over the years. And one began to realize that not only was the story never really told, it was completely muddled and very, very, it was lost in a complete maze of half-truths, and if I may say so, even lies. I wanted to, therefore, take my time and write this book over a period of years. And I did that. I was fortunate that my own career graph also sort of opened up like that. I initially spent some time in Ladakh working with Tiger Tops. I opened up major parts of Ladakh in the early 1980s. So that allowed me to keep expanding my own interests, keep looking at the situation in Kashmir. I was perhaps fortunate that I also got to spend a lot of time with Sheikh Abdullah, because his office was with us in Srinagar itself. I now wish I knew more about Kashmir. I could have asked him a few more very pertinent questions, but of course, you know, everybody goes through his own evolution. My job was such that I had to actually walk a lot in Ladakh. So there isn't a single valley or a particular region which we haven't done a reconnaissance of or whatever. And then again, I was very fortunate that my father at that time was commanding 70 Infantry Brigade, which was based in Kyari, which is a part of 3 Division in Ladakh. So that gave me another opportunity to further study the eastern Ladakh area, which is today very much in the news. When you're talking about Galwan Valley, you're talking about Karakash, you're talking about DBO. These were names which meant nothing to anybody till even a few years ago. In 2011, for example, I had visited Leh and I had been invited by the Corps commander to come and speak to them. And I had focused on the Galwan Valley, and I was a little surprised to see that even in the 14 Corps headquarters, very few people were aware of this region. It was almost like a kind of a forgotten area. 1962, the book that which I finally wrote is about 35 years of research. And I also feel that had it come out, say, 5 years earlier, or maybe it would have been before its time. And it may not have done as well as it has subsequently done. And what has really been a bit of an eye-opener has been the fact that people across the board are willing to listen to what actually happened. You see, The War That Wasn't is a book about a defeat. And nobody likes to actually read too much into, you know, how you got walloped. And that's the only word for it. That, you know, the Chinese went through us like a knife through butter. And the lessons that one has to draw from that are numerous. I mean, it is not just one or two things. And what we also must realize, because a part of the book also deals with the historical buildup in Tibet and in various other parts. What we have to realize is that with China, we have a perennial problem. I mean, it is not going to go away. You know, the Chinese have a saying that there cannot be two tigers on a single hill. And they look at India as a completely different ball game. And right from the start, ever since the communist Chinese overthrew the Kuomintang government, and, you know, we suddenly had a new neighbor until 1948-49, till Mao Zedong came to power, China was not our neighbor. We had Tibet on most of our northern front and Xinjiang on the other side. But these were changes that took place. It was a major land grab by the PRC, by the communist Chinese. And the other thing that we also must realize when we're looking at the historical perspective is that China has a land border with 14 countries, or, you know, their neighbor 14 countries. And they have a problem not just with us, they have a problem with just about everybody else, including Nepal. And they have played their cards in a very systematic manner. They have played the Pakistan card. which Pakistan also was created around the same time. It's been a cat's paw in keeping India unstable. The region lends itself to all kinds of issues. And unfortunately, on the Indian side, I find, you know, my own analysis and my own experiences that we have somehow always, you know, Ram Bharose chal rahe. You know, there's so many problems on our front. It is not funny. I mean, I think when Sanjay will also, Brigadier Agarwal will also elaborate on some of these when we talk about it. You know, the way we are structured, we have our border management is wonky. We have the border management is actually not a Ministry of Defense problem today. It comes under the Ministry of Home Affairs. This was exactly the situation in 1962 where B.N. Malik was calling the shots in Ladakh. It was an IB problem. The very few people realize that the fighting in Nifa in 1962, when it did happen, the army, until a year before that, was not even in the picture. It was held by the Assam Rifles, which was under the under the External Affairs Ministry. Because this area was known as the unadministered areas. And, you know, there were a lot of... We've always been very defensive. Our own overall military perspective has been, in my opinion, somewhat flawed. We have not been serious enough about our own... the threats that we face when things sort of settle down for a while, we just sort of sweep everything under the carpet. We've had scandal after scandal after scandal in defense procurement. I think it has affected our overall preparedness. And what we must realize is that we are facing a very, very, very dangerous enemy in the form of China. So that, I think, basically sums up the basic background. And as I mentioned a little bit while earlier, the interest in the book, especially 1962, is not limited to scholars and just people like that, but it has been very widespread, including schools and stuff like that. For example, we've been holding these military history seminars in Vellum Boys, and we got, you know, just about every elite school in India as a part of it. And the interest in these matters has been tremendous, and I'm glad to see that in the younger generation.
Shiv Kunal, you know, in your book you've mentioned about some of the brutalities that were committed by the Chinese army at that time, and the manner in which they went about it, and the manner in which they have been orchestrating these kind of brutalities whenever they've got that opportunity. And recently also, when we had this face-off in Ladakh and Galwan Valley, we came across those incidents where Chinese soldiers came with barbed wires, and even though it was hand-to-hand and there was no guns, yet there was a certain level of very, very distressing use of brutal strength. Do you think that... You know, I'm talking of it in the context of your book, that psychologically we have come out of that era where we could be psyched out by things like that, and we become stronger, and we will no longer get psyched out by that, but be able to retaliate in adequate measure. Or you think that we are still pusillanimous and soft as human beings, or our soldiers are tough and strong and won't let such a thing happen? What is your thought on that?
I'm glad you brought that up, because in Bhopal, you have Mrs. Naidu, who's the daughter of Colonel Awasthi.
General Milan Naidu.
And Niharika, I call her Didi. Now, her father was Colonel Awasthi. He was commanding for Rajput. He, along with a lot of other people, our casualties happened after the ceasefire in a very large number. One of the Chinese units was actually tasked to go on the double, get behind our lines and look for stragglers and not take prisoners. They shot people in cold blood after the ceasefire. This was a war crime. In fact, we were unfortunately so much on the back foot, we could never really pay any emphasis on a thing like this. And why did they do this? They did this because they wanted to instill absolute and complete terror in the Indian psyche. And to a great extent, they did succeed. But then events have unfolded over the years where you know, there was the Nathula incident in 1967, as you know. Again, 18 Rajput was one of the key units involved in that. They were the battalion which was laying the barbed wire when the incident took place. When the initial Chinese attack happened in Nathula, there was a tendency among the troops holding the front to actually get up and start pulling out, but they were stopped. And I'm glad to see that it was 18 Rajput who stopped them. But the event in Nathula actually psychologically started to at least diminish that 9-foot Chinaman image, which China has very carefully inculcated, and they have been working on it. It's on the social media, on everything. They're constantly trying to instill fear in you. Then happened the Sum Trong Chu incident in 1986-87, where we were very fortunate in having a very, very firm army commander in General Nirhari. He was very clear, and I think we took some proactive steps there, and we actually managed to clear out that whole area of the Chinese intrusion. Then came Galwan. Galwan is, of course, much later, but before that came Doklam. And again, in Doklam, I think the Indians have reacted with a lot of maturity. On the ground, the army is no longer going to get bro-beaten. They were not bro-beaten in 62 either. They were just poorly led. We were killed while we were pulling out. Had every time the Indian soldiers, even in 62, stood up and fought the Chinese, whether it was at Nam Ka Chu, whether it was at Wolong, whether it was at Sela, you know, it was absolutely fantastic. In fact, the Chinese official casualties, they have admitted to 786 dead and about 3,000 wounded. Now, if you really look at the fighting that has taken place in Ladakh and in Nifar, it is over a period of just 2 or 3 days. And from our side, there was only one brigade in, not even a brigade, there were actually only one or two battalions that were actually engaged by the Chinese in Nifar. And as far as Ladakh is concerned, we actually had virtually no troops there. And yet, the Chinese have had fairly severe casualties. We don't have to get carried away by all that stuff about one Indian killing 300 Chinese and all that is, of course, all Bollywood masala. But, you know, if you really actually see the admitted Chinese casualties, they're extremely high. Galwan, when it has finally happened, the brutality of Galwan, I think, surprised everybody. But Galwan, I also feel, looking at the way the thing unfolded, it is not really a... it became a free-for-all kind of a skirmish in which, but I don't think it was something which was really planned as a terror attack as such. It just sort of, it seems like that situation got a little bit out of hand over there, and it kind of flared up, which is a real problem that you face across this 4,000 long kilometer where you're eyeball to eyeball with these guys. And, you know, any time, anything can flare up because tempers and everything are going to flare up every time there is an intrusion. So we have a very, very dangerous scenario.
Let me ask Brigadier Sanjay Agarwal your take on the psyche of the Indian military officer and how well prepared is he to deal with any kind of dispute or conflict or war situation in the future. Are people strongly geared dealing with those situations, and are they being suitably backed up by the rest of the country? That means all of us as civilians, as defense officers, as diplomats, as administrators. Do you think the military is well prepared to deal with a combative and expansionist and an aggressive China?
Thank you, Raghav. It's a pleasure to be on this panel. Thank you, Team BLF, and thank you all attendees for logging in or staying logged in. It's a pleasure to be once again with Shiv Kunal Verma in a discussion. And now coming to your question, and more importantly, the second half of your question. Without a shadow of a doubt, the Indian military, the Army, Navy, and Air Force are very much prepared but also remember what General Malik, as the chief of the Indian Army, had said once officially and publicly, we will fight with what we have. And for a designation of that stature to say this much says a lot. Things have improved, things are improving. And the major battle winning factor and the major surprise, both perpetually for Pakistan, earlier in Siachen and then in Kargil, and later for China in 2017 in Doklam and on 16th or 15th June 2020 in Galwan, and now in the winter, is the grit, determination, valor, nationalism, restraint, the level of training of the entire setup of the Indian military. This was also displayed in the Balakot strikes by the Indian Air Force and by the behavior of then Wing Commander Abhinandan and the body language of his when he was finally released. So on the first part of the question, there is not a shadow of a doubt. Now, the second part of the question is, are we adequately backed up by the rest of the country? Instead of answering this, I would state a few facts and then maybe answer a bit. We have a politician in Bihar who proclaims they are paid to die. So what's the big deal? How motivating? There are our soldiers earlier, 30 years earlier, when as junior officers, we would write to the district collector because we didn't write to the SDMs. We always wrote to the collector that so-and-so Jawan is facing a problem. He's not getting his 8 bags of cement for his house construction in so-and-so place. Within 15 days, the job was done. We would get the letter back in another 15 days, both from the Jawan and from the office of the collector. Does it happen anymore? The moment a Jawan is back home for his leave period to look after his family, and understand that today with the mobile communication, the home problems are conveyed instantly to the Jawan on the border.
I do appreciate that. Shiv Kunal, let me go back to you and ask you, you know, along a similar theme, you've been, you know, in some of your recent articles which have got published, you've taken on so-called paper tigers, you've exhorted that should castigate those who drum up hysteria and into Chinese hands. You've talked about changing the narrative. You know, there are several questions there. What exactly do you mean by all that?
See, as I mentioned a little bit earlier, the Chinese have been constantly playing this game with us. They playing mind games with us all the time. And a lot of people in our media have been actually, you know, some of this initial reporting on Galwan, etc., was a little skewed. It wasn't very accurate. And it was building up a lot of war hysteria. I don't want to name people, but some of these gentlemen have been suspect in the past. We had one of these people very actively involved in actually the whole, what we call the Siachen, you know, they wanted to hand over Siachen and withdraw from there. So, you know, this was one aspect which we tried to address. The second, of course, was that I have been advocating all along that we need to get very aggressive. I had suggested, I think the last article in the series that I wrote for the Sunday Guardian, I had suggested that, look, don't get into a kind of a, you cannot match China. Economically, etc., militarily, they are, it's a mug's game. But where are we really strong? Why don't we need to actually look at this G219, G314 and G315 highway? This is China's lifeline. It is their highway in the sky, as they call it. Just like when we look at the South China Sea down below, where they are petrified about being blocked off in the Malacca Straits at the, you know, the sea lanes over there. This is their big lane up here. The Chinese, according to a lot of our own analysts, were getting very jumpy because we had moved into DBO, we were building a road there. Therefore, about 30 kilometers of G219 was, according to them, suddenly vulnerable. Therefore, the Chinese were doing XYZ and they were pushing into the Daesang plains. They were doing all kinds of things in Galwan, etc., etc. We need to actually target the entire 4,000 kilometers. What's stopping us? For years, we've been parading these deadly missiles on Rajpath, and we've been giving Padma Shris and God knows what to just about all our DRDO scientists, and the ISRO has done a fantastic job. Our main strength is missiles. You bracket that entire area. You don't make a secret of it. You don't do it quietly. You say you do it publicly. Behave like North Korea. You say that, look, you enter any valley, whether it is in eastern Ladakh, whether it is in the Satluj Valley, whether it is across Nepal, whether it is in Sikkim, whether it is in Bhutan, we are going to retaliate. And we will hit you on the highway, we will hit your oil lines, we'll hit your railway lines. It becomes a deterrent. I'm not saying open fire, I'm just saying, and you have the capability. We have all types of missiles. We can hit Peking if it comes to it. Now, when this article came out, there were two types of reactions to it. I got a call from a very senior opposition leader, who's a very good friend of mine, and he went ballistic. He says, you're advocating nuclear war. I said, I'm not. I'm actually suggesting quite the opposite. Because China will play, see, China is a bully. Let's be very frank about it. China will, if it's like water, they find a vacuum, they get into it. They've done it again and again and again. Now the point is, we can keep reacting to it. We can keep flying in divisions. We can keep doing all kinds of things. It's a mug's game. We are not a fluent country. We've got to be concentrating on education. We've got to be looking at agriculture. We've got huge, huge problems. So this is your cheapest alternative. Get aggressive, bracket the entire area. And the other point is that build on your IAF. The IAF was not used in 1962. Had they used the Air Force in 62, it would have been a different story. The Air Force today, if you actually analyze the situation in Eastern Ladakh or Western Tibet, as they call it, the entire thing is in our favor. The high altitude airfields, the inability to carry heavy weapons, etc. The Indian Air Force has bases which completely neutralize these guys. So we really need to have a very clear-cut strategy, and we need to... We've never been the aggressors. So we don't have to become the aggressors, but there's nothing to say that, look, if you get funny with me, you come here, I'm going to hit you there. That's what boxing is all about, isn't it? I mean, you have your guard up, you block, and you hit.
We've spoken about fighting on the land. We've spoken about the use of aviation and Air Force. Talking about the Navy, and which Chief Kunal also briefly mentioned, and the South China Seas, and when India started participating in the joint operations in the South China Seas, the refrain was that India is playing into U.S. hands, and therefore China is terribly annoyed with it, and some of the events that have taken place are either preemptive or as a sort of express their annoyance at our participating in an area which we've got nothing to do with directly. So what is your thought on that and the relevance of India participating in operations in the South China Seas deal with China?
I'm not a great fan of jumping into the American basket. Okay, the Americans have never done anybody any good. I have always advocated that India has to be self-reliant. India has to be stand on its own feet. It's our war. I mean, if they come there, there's no point running to Uncle Sam and saying, please tell them to behave themselves in Tibet or whatever. We have to have the punching ability to strike back. The Indian Navy is sitting on a pig's back, actually. We are a very powerful Navy. Let us not have any doubts about that. Because we are, somehow we are a Delhi-based thinking, we don't really think maritime. But the Navy over the years has developed fantastic capabilities. The Navy is the most powerful Navy in the Indian Ocean, this side of the Malacca Straits. And when you say it's not really our war, I don't exactly agree there, because our interests are, you know, China is very clear. They're not your friends. You can get into any kind of economic agreements with them, etc. If you show any sign of weakness, they're going to climb onto you. So, I mean, you know, as far as the Quad is concerned, everything is concerned, I wasn't very, personally not very happy with the fact that India is linked to the US, because I would love to be completely self-independent and handle it. Carry your own stick. It amounts to that. I'm sure, Brigadier Agarwal, you would have...
Well, Sanjay, please comment on that. Your mic.
On the South China Sea, allow me to set the context for our audience as well and share what it involves, etc. So just let me go down. South China Sea, and we will see what exactly is at stake and how it is important for us. So here you have the South China Sea and the littoral states around it. And on the far left of your screen is India. The Malacca Straits are here, just between Singapore and Indonesia, here. And remember, the Andamans are as the gateway to this. This is the area where the Kra Isthmus was being planned and has been shelved. And remember that the Kaladan project is here in Myanmar. Now, with this as a background, what is the importance of the South China Sea? I will come back to these. The importance is here. The South China Sea is home to 30% of the global trade. And in terms of natural resources, this is what it has as an estimate. Oil, natural gas, fisheries. And then you come back to what is the status of this place. In 1599, China had its wind sail trading ships, of which there are photographs. So Philippines here took China to the International Court of Arbitration over the Spratly Islands, which are here. This is the Paracel Islands, which are boxed. Spratly Islands are here. And on the 12th of July, 2016, the International Permanent Court of Arbitration ruled unanimously in favor of Philippines. And China blatantly ignores it and continues with its claims based on the 9-line. Now, this is the 9-line, which is marked here in 9 dashes. It is the same thing here. It is the same thing in the Himalayas, where they refuse to exchange annotated maps with their perception of the LSE and our perception, their perception of the border and our perception. That is the foundation of any meaningful conflict resolution. They don't want that conflict resolution. This fundamental needs to be understood. And China, despite the last 4.5 years of this resolution by an International Permanent Court of Arbitration, refuses. Now, why does it refuse? Is because of the EEZ, which I have now highlighted. Ignore Formosa earlier, Taiwan now for the moment. Ignore further north in the East China Sea, the Senkaku Islands and Japan. Focus on the South China Sea, which your question deals with. Everybody's EEZ is marked. And yet, in total regard, disregard to everybody's EEZ, the red one is what China says, which means Vietnam can go to hell, Philippines can go to hell, and so everybody else also. This is the importance. And when I say this part, it is its attitude, the revanchist attitude of the leadership, much magnified now in Mr. Xi Jinping. Now come to what is the Indian interest, etc. We have the Malacca Straits here, and just below Indonesia, this side, we have the Sunda Straits. All the global trade passing from here, the Malacca Strait is a choke point this side, and on the Indian Ocean side, to enter the Mediterranean, the choke points are there. And that is why China has got its foot in the door at Djibouti. And that is why also, to connect Djibouti over a land route, it has got Gwadar port in Pakistan. The South China Sea is important for international shipping. See, my focus, and this is the world agreement, that China should not be handled one on one by any country. Like Shiv also said, you know, they are way ahead of us, so we can't tackle them. The way to tackle China is multilaterally. And exactly the opposite is what China wants. I will come to this when we come to the specifics on taming the dragon. I'm sure I'll have an opportunity to speak on that issue. So here, what India, I had said this in June when I used to repeatedly go on TV last year. The solution to the Himalayan problem lies in the oceans. India must leverage its island territories, both in the Bay of Bengal and in the Indian Ocean. We have the Andamans here, and we have the Lakshadweep Islands there, and we have friendly countries like Mauritius and Seychelles, where I've been there for 2 years as an advisor to that country. So I did whatever I could, and that was a lot. And today we have a foothold there in the Assumption Islands. It's being made. It was stalled under the previous dispensation. That gentleman is now the president, and India is taking it forward actively. The South China Sea, we have to have a respect for international law, which means EEZ, which is why China is, for the last 25 years, on a spree of artificial islands. And this spree was accelerated from 2011, and you relate it to Xi Jinping coming into the scene, and you see what is there. These practices were fundamentally piles of sand. This is how they were, nothing. And what happened? This is the picture of the 12th July arbitration. The underlined part says it is unanimous award. And this is what happened to the various reefs over there. The consecutive pictures, I'll show you a few blow-ups for the benefit of the audience. What was and what China has made it. The gravity of the problem is understood when you see these pictures. Can you see a few piles of sand becoming this with a full runway, with a full protected bay? It's a proper air and naval base, right in the middle of an area which is not theirs in the first place. And now they want to use the international law in their favor to apply the EEZ rule that this is ours, hence 200 nautical miles around it is ours. Look at the development in this reef. And this I am showing you how they do it. I have seen it myself in Seychelles, how they do artificial island building. They made a huge new neighborhood, and they made a huge mini township there so that more people could stay on the main island of Victoria. This is a ship pumping sand. And how many ships do they use together? Have a look. And all this sand is getting to the coast, to extend the coast here. And how much of it, what is the output? 3.5 acres of new land every day. If this is not disconcerting, what is? So with this background of the South China Sea, what are the solutions? The solutions are what steps have been taken to revitalize Quad. Quad fundamentally, as on date, is a security dialogue. There is thought that could it and should it mutate into having more military muscle and a NATO-like alliance?
Yeah, I must note you there because you've given us an overview of the subject on this topic. So we have to move ahead.
Okay.
And since there are questions from the audience, surely we'll take them up as well. But before I come to the questions, a couple of rapid fire questions to Kunal and you. And was equally to both of you. One, now that the Chinese have forced us to park our soldiers in absolutely blistering, cold, chilly slopes with perhaps not the best of clothing and equipment, what next from the Dragon? What should we anticipate? Brigadier Sanjay.
The last sentence that you said before, what should we anticipate? The last sentence?
You know, our soldiers are already parked and are forced to touch themselves to defend our borders in chilly climate. Do you think this is just a ploy of China to kind of wear us out psychologically? Or do you think they are actually planning to do something?
Okay. Let's first understand that in the Chinese and Japanese cultures, loss of face is unacceptable, including in students. It leads to suicide. In the present episode, with its aspirations to global leadership, China cannot afford to lose face, and it has appeared to have lost some face. Therefore, yes, China will not keep quiet, number one. Number two, what will it do? So when you ask what will it do, the first question is what did it do? What was its intent? To what level that intent was achieved? We will ignore that because of paucity of time. What will it do? China will wait for a suitable fracture, fault line, engineered opportunity. Remember, influence operations, China is a PhD. It can influence things, including in India. You would be aware that the Chinese Communist Party, which is actually China, just like Pakistan Army has a country to look after it, the Communist Party of China has the country of mainland China to look after it. This party has a MOU with one of our parties, and there are communist parties in India and various elements. So China will wait for two things. A sharp military action at a place and time of its choosing. And at the hybrid larger level, it will seek to give a dressing down to India to bring India to its rightful place, which in China's perception is number two to China, for which it is working hard on a larger front, which I will talk about when we talk about taming the dragon. That's it.
Shiv Kunal, your views on what China can be expected to do next?
I was in Taiwan 2 years ago. I also met the president, and we attended a conference on what is likely to happen. And it's amazing as to how many people had sketched out a likely scenario which unfolded the way it did. Basically, of course, I agree with what Brigadier Agarwal is saying, but I have a slight differing point there, opinion there. I think China in this particular period, I'm talking about 2020, and here the COVID, everything comes into play. I think China overplayed its hand because they worked on one assumption, which was that the Indians are going to buckle in rather easily once there is pressure put on them in Ladakh. That has somehow not gone the way they anticipated it. Also, I think the fact that, President Trump losing out on the US side, etc., they're going to actually bide their time. They're going to take in about 2 or 3 years, but they're going to come back at you. The time frame is exactly where I differ with what Brigadier Sanjay Agarwal is saying. I feel that they are going to use the next 3-4 years to further build up their military, further look at where all they were actually stalled at this point of time. Because on the other side, whether it is India, whether it is the United States, and as he said, they are past masters at engineering all kinds of internal rifts and problems. There are a lot of things happening in India which almost certainly the Chinese have a major role. They have a cyber cell working out there, looking at just about everything. There are thousands of people involved in it. We are not even aware of the magnitude and the scale at which they are working. And that's not only applicable to India, it's as applicable to the United States. They have a new administration in the US whom they see as a weaker from the, if you look at what the Taiwanese and everybody do, they would have preferred to have Trump there because at least Trump was somebody who was facing up to the Chinese and calling them, at least naming them. Today, I'm not even sure if that is going to happen. So I think there's going to be a period of about 4 or 5 years. China is going to try and they are obviously looking at where they went wrong, what were the assumptions which didn't quite work in their favor. They're going to try and come at you that much harder. And at the same time, as Brigadier Agarwal said, keep undermining you, keep cutting you. You're going to have a whole lot of internal problems which you think will be internal, but actually they're all being done by them. And 4 years from now, just see the chaos that they're going to try and engineer. Whether we fall for it or not is a different story.
In your articles, Shiv Kunal, you've mentioned somewhere that the original documents relating to Tibet and its the geographical validity and the political validity of China taking over Tibet, the rest in Taiwan. Why haven't we been able to get them and work through the International Court of Justice and bodies like that and drum that up adequately? What are your thoughts on that?
Well, actually, again, we got so fired up by this 2 years ago when I was there. In fact, when I met the president, she had read my book and she was very complimentary about it. And I told her, I said, ma'am, you have all the original documents because all the, not just with India, even with Mongolia, even with all the other countries, because it's the Kuomintang government which has signed everything. I mean, just because Mao Zedong comes to power and he says, well, yeah, it was like this, everybody is, you're looking at a post-World War II scenario where everybody was completely exhausted. And, he managed to just bulldoze his way through the whole thing. Dig out those documents. In fact, there's a Supreme Court lawyer. He got very involved with us. And we were even looking at, I said, individually, I don't mind putting in all my savings. Let's go to the International Court of Justice and let's see what we can do. And why just India? Why not look at the entire thing? I just briefly mentioned this point to the Taiwanese president, and she said, as an individual, I can't give you these. Your government has to ask for it. But the problem is, India has always been very, very wary as far as it comes to China. I mean, there were those international airline routes which had got changed, and there was a map which was published where from Republic of China, they said Taiwan or something, and the Chinese objected, and we destroyed something like 10 million maps and we redid them. So, we have to stop just buckling into the jigs and just to the Chinese and standing up to them and get aggressive. I've been advocating this for a very, very long time, that stop letting, they are playing this mind games with you, and so long as you, unless you play them back, you're not going to succeed.
I guess one of the thoughts which does this thing is that we've been looking at our relations with China largely through a diplomatic lens, and diplomacy tends to build in cordiality, consensuality, and status quoism. But perhaps today we require a strategic and perhaps even an economic lens to deal with China, apart from the military lens. So Brigadier Sanjay Agarwal, I'd like to have your quick thoughts on whether India should collaborate with China to become economically strong, tap in their potentialities and their complementarities with us and make ourselves economically strong. Or do you think we should compete with them and make ourselves economically strong using our own resources, our own independent systems, and about joining the, we've heard of BRI, but BRI is strategic in terms of, of economic cooperation vis-a-vis and building links in infrastructure, but I'm talking of RCEP. For instance, India did not sign the regional cooperation agreement, which includes 15 Asia-Pacific nations and about 30% of the world's GDP. And China is a predominant member of that. And some of the countries in the South China Seas that we talk of as being hurt by China are actually cooperating with China. So what's your perspective and take on how those issues are emerging and what India's position should be? Brigadier Sanjay Agarwal.
So So on the RCEP, first let me talk of the RCEP, Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership, and then I will talk of the overview. So there are a number of reasons why this does not go in India's favor. Number one, India had asked for the base year to be shifted from 2014 to a more recent base year. This was not allowed. Number two, if India joins RCEP, it amounts to a free trade agreement with China, with all the advantages of this backdoor entry being with China. Third, the agreement does not protect against import surges, and nor does it address India's demands, which are global, that when you talk of globalization and movement of products and material, please also talk of free movement of services and movement of professionals, the human capital. The agreement does not cater for that. And therefore, there are other issues where we wanted a cap on the amount of export from a country so that we could limit the trade deficit. And therefore, we wanted rules of origins of goods. This didn't happen. Now, when we talk about why services were excluded, I was surprised to read that our earlier Prime Minister, Mr. Manmohan Singh, had signed and agreed to this exclusion in 2009. There must have been reasons. I am ignorant of them. And therefore, what should India do? That is the end of everything that I want to talk about. India is already exploring trade agreements with developed countries. Reason being, in the manufacturing sector, China is way ahead. Its costing is much lower. It has got indentured labor. It puts people in prison, the Uyghur Muslims, and uses them for free labor. And therefore, India would like to also market its services. These would be more competitive in the Western world rather than in ASEAN. That's it.
Kunal Verma, let me ask you, the banning of Chinese apps, that was a tactical move. And do you think steps like that, putting the lens of scrutiny through the Home Ministry on Chinese investments in India, etc., are these the correct tactical measures in terms of dealing with the Chinese psyche, of aggressiveness? Do you think that these are not adequate and they do not play any significant role in the larger strategic thinking against China?
I think what we have to see is actually consistency. Whatever we do, we have to have we cannot be at one level saying ban their apps and telling people don't buy anything Chinese, and at the same time having agreements with them at state levels and stuff like that, working on that. I want to make a point vis-a-vis your earlier statement. It may not be politically correct to say it, but the earlier thing that, the Ministry of External Affairs in the last, since 1962, has adopted, in my view, let sleeping dogs lie. That kind of in fact, that's a phrase which is very frequently used by Indian diplomats, and I think that has been a fundamental mistake right throughout. And I think they are now beginning to wake up to the reality of what has actually happened, because I don't think they quite anticipated and really expected the Chinese to pop up in Ladakh the way they did. There is now a mind shift in India, and I think the banning of apps and everything reflects that. At least we are doing something. We are standing up to, we made it very clear to the Chinese that if it comes to it, every man jack in India is going to stand up and fight you no matter what. It's not just the soldiers, it's even we've got a very, very for the concept of India as a nation today is very different from the concept of India as a nation when we were a newly independent country. There were a lot of fractures which have cemented over now. Today, you talk to anybody, except for a few isolated groups here and there, everybody sees himself as an Indian. And whether they are Manipuris or their Tamilians or whatever, they're going to fight till to the last when it comes to the Chinese in the northern boundaries. Now it really doesn't matter. So India as a unified concept is also there. But again, we have multiple fault lines which they are going to keep exploiting. They're going to keep pushing. They're going to keep doing. So it's a game of chess. And you know what happens today, if that move doesn't happen. What we've got to be very, very careful about, Raghav, is that we don't get into this political nonsense of chest thumping and we did this and we did that, because this is an ongoing game. It's like a cricket match. And the way the Indians have batted out the last few, you know, the last wicket partnership that held out and stood up to the Australians, took all that battering that they did. I'm talking about Ashwin and Vihari. India has to actually now actually look at China from that perspective. And then at the same time, work on your Rishabh Pants and Rohit Sharma's, who can take the attack to them and then, you know, completely change the game, ball game around. You got to start thinking aggressive, and you've got to, at the same time, make sure that Fortress India is a fortress.
Well said. Before we come to the question answers, quickly, though we are stretched for time, Brigadier Sanjay Agarwal, your thoughts on moving ahead to tame the dragon?
Okay. So here are the thoughts. It'll save time if I show you this. And I will speak after a second. Here are the thoughts. China prefers one-to-one bilateral. The world wants to deal collectively, multilaterally with China. That's obvious. Respect for law and its absence, I've spoken about. We have to enforce it, and we can as a world. China has a stranglehold on the world bodies. We only know of WHO and Mr. Tedros. He's not a doctor, by the way. As the Director General of the World Health Organization, he's not a doctor. And WHO is the only one we know. There are many others. The Chinese control of the international narrative, that is something which is phenomenal. Confucius Institutes, this, that, and the other, the amount of money they are pouring in into these things is something that India has to learn, which it has not learned so far. So how to train the dragon is what we are talking about. And these are some of the measures that I am saying. The intent, when we talk of stranglehold on the world bodies through small country votes, how do they get the votes? It comes back to the data. Now you'll say Google and Facebook also have our data, but the intent, the sinister intent of China in how it will use the data against countries and against specific policymakers to get its goals and undertake coercive diplomacy and coercive economics and be able to influence political debates and even national narrative and national decision-making. These are the issues that I want to share with you. So, and when I spoke about the Chinese control of the narrative, influence operations, psychological operations, control of international media, right from the Boston Times to the Chicago Times, the narrative in universities and colleges, Confucius Institutes I've mentioned. Now I want to come, how do we tame the dragon? The nature of war, even Kunal touched on this, that it is not just a soldier now, the whole country. Lal Bahadur Shastri Ji had said this earlier, that the preservation of freedom is not only the task of soldiers alone, the whole nation has to be strong. So from army only to all of government and now to all of country, I'm afraid there is a lot of work India has to do in this all of country approach to an all-encompassing hybrid form of warfare that we are now already witnessing. It is not the future, it is the present. The second thing that India has to do to tame the dragon is policy interventions, specifically in the areas of, as mentioned on that slide earlier, trade, company acquisitions, investments, clearances to Chinese projects and proposals, visas. Our ships are facing problems when they are docking or wanting to dock for 3 months. I have spoken to the captain of the merchant vessel. 3 months they were kept outside. Confucius Institutes, I've spoken about leveraging India's island territories by policy interventions. What prevents Andamans to become another Singapore? Nothing. The next point is the tolerance thresholds of India were very, very high earlier and were a national, international laughing stock. Now it's much better in the last 5-7 years. The red lines must be clear, but how much you will tolerate should not be clear. And your response must carry the unpredictability of response India has shown in the surgical strikes, in the Balakot strikes, etc. The Chinese themselves are inscrutable. We were highly predictable. And then we come to capacity building. The rare earth elements and lithium is one bucket. I'm happy to say day before yesterday, I read the report, whereas in lithium, the major countries are the Southwest block of South America, which is fundamentally Bolivia, Argentina, and Chile, followed by America, Australia, and China. India has discovered lithium in Karnataka in the area of Mandya. Very good news, and exploration is on in 4 other states. Rare earth elements, the 15, 17 elements which we forgot in the periodic table, they are the future. And China has major mining rights in South America. This is the capacity building we require. Sadly, India did create a national government institute for this in 1950, 70 years ago. Output, targets, accountability, let's leave it there. API, active pharmaceutical ingredients of medicines, which India proudly claims that we make 70% of API, we are still getting from China to make those medicines. Industry and manufacturing, electronic warfare capability, all these things require capacity building. Apps we have spoken about, basic R&D, innovations, supply chain management, shipbuilding, semiconductor manufacture. This point I had raised when I was the advisor to the Home Ministry. It was shocking to me that with our aspirations, we have not really focused because it's a very capital intensive industry. Taiwan is making, China is making, we are not. And the last point is soft power, influence operations, selling your narrative. China is very good in this. What is Bollywood doing? And there are various other things that we've spoken about on this. And the last point about the good part on the trade. For the first time, it happened that we have now bucked the trend of the ballooning trade deficit. It was in 2018-19 that the first decrease was noticed. 2019, and before that, for the last 15 years, I have studied the figures, it was increasing.
Okay, Sanjay, Brigadier Sanjay, I have to cut you off there. And okay. Shiv Kunal Verma, are you there? Okay, so we have to take a couple of questions, and questions are all there. The first one I'm going to read out, and please let me know if you can react to them. Why did China do what it did in Ladakh? Are they successful in this strategy? Quick answers. We need quick responses, like military surgical strike kind of responses. So, Brigadier Sanjay Agarwal.
Okay.
So, one line answers, please.
Yes. 30 second answer. Why did China do what it did? It wanted to establish India as number two and itself as number one. Its intent was correct. It miscalculated the new Indian resolve because it took Doklam as an aberration.
Kunal Verma, what is your view on that question? One line answers.
Ladakh is... Sorry, I was pushing the dogs out. They were being...
Yeah, Why did China do what it did in Ladakh, and were they successful in their strategy?
China is going to continue to do things in Ladakh. They're going to continue doing things in Nepal. They're going to continue doing things up Nepal. I don't think, as I've already mentioned, I don't think they were very successful this time. But that doesn't mean that they're going to give it up.
Okay. Sanjay Agrawal, Brigadier. Sir, the South China Sea scenario, and how can we do that better there? I think this we've dealt with in great detail. Yeah. How does the RECP impact us? We've discussed this in detail. Anonymous attendee, wow. What are the prospects of India and China reaching an agreement on LAC? China had land boundary disputes with 14 countries and can have settled them with 12, with India and Bhutan remaining. Can India do anything about that?
Yes. Firstly, dear anonymous attendee, let us be clear that China has a border with 14 countries. It has a dispute with 18 countries. And this report of 12 of them having been resolved was in Global Times. It is Chinese propaganda. Second, the LAC I touched upon, they do not want it demarcated. They want to function in the gray zone. Ambiguity suits their salami slicing. They're keeping India on tenterhooks. The earlier India, which was timid and never went forward. 29th of August night, we went forward on the Kailash Range. So the prospects of reaching an agreement, there are short-term, mid-term, and long-term objectives. The first objective is China to revert to April 2020 status quo ante. The mid-term objective is exchange maps, which they have refused to for historically, and thereby understand each other's perception of the LAC. And the last objective is resolve the boundary dispute. I don't see this last one happening anywhere in the midterm also. I don't see the first two happening in the near term either.
I don't see China resolving this particular issue, but I also feel that we need to educate our own people as to what the real history of the area is. We are also quite in the dark.
Okay. Next question to Brigadier Sanjay Agrawal. Boycott of Chinese goods help India's cause at all?
100%. Do not look at it only in monetary terms. Look at it as, when I said war, military to all of government, to all of country, when you boycott Diwali lights and goods, this is the all of country approach where each shopkeeper, the traders association, etc., are contributing and there is national bonding happening. India needs that bonding. So it helps India's cause tremendously, but there's a caveat. The caveat is, in heavy machinery, we cannot, because we don't have alternatives and the German machinery is too expensive where the alternative is. So we cannot boycott all of Chinese goods immediately. We have to do our capacity building before we can do that.
Kunal Verma on that subject.
I completely endorse what Sanjay said.
So with that, we will come to the end of this session. Thank you very much, Shiv Kunal Verma and Brigadier Sanjay Agrawal. It's been a extremely illuminating, vibrant, and purposeful and meaningful session. I will request Mrinalini to please convey the vote of thanks.
Thank you so much, Brigadier Sanjay Agarwal and Shiv Kunal Verma ji. It was a very enlightening and interesting session for me, especially because I keep hearing a lot about this Indo-China issue, especially from my dad. He's in the army. So I keep listening a lot, and thanks for shedding a new and different light on this Indo-China issue, especially from the point of view of the border disputes and the trade aspects. And I thank all our audience for joining us in BLF 2021, despite of the constraints of COVID-19 pandemic. And hope to see you all soon next year for BLF 2022. And thanks for all the love and support of the audience and all the attendees. And thanks all the authors and the discussants who took their precious time and joined us and given us different insights on various subjects. Thank you so much.